Shrine, get another message from the shrine, you know, or let's see, lessons from the shrine. We got a couple of titles now. There's so many good ones, I'm forgetting them. I almost feel like I'm gonna take some of those titles and make shows just out of the titles themselves. But yeah, in any event, I'm on the move early this dawning and getting some things done. So I wanted to give a brief little lesson today. Well, I don't want to call it a lesson. Brief little insight to think about, right? Little insight to think about. Okay, so I spoke about something recently in regards to age and wisdom and knowledge, and also even the, you know, where the segment where I did Elders Sing the Blues and the remembered and different ideas that we have surrounding being birth, you know, birth, and as well as being sent into death transition, right? And the fact that it's not an instantaneous thing. Well, I wanted to speak about something that's related to it a bit really quickly, and that's the idea of wisdom, right? And often wisdom becomes a thing that trips us up, you know, in terms of the work that we do. You know, I had an experience a few days ago where I was handling some business, and I had been discussing some things with an elder of mine as far as what we were going to do and what we were going to take care of. And we had to go to his elder, which is the head of the family, in order to basically get the final yes, you can do this, or no, you can't do this, right? So during that time, his elder wasn't really being as agreeable to the terms that we had discussed and worked out and figured we're cool and we're gonna work. And my elder sat there silent the entire time, didn't really advocate, didn't really say anything, just this is what it is, you know. Wasn't happy about what he was hearing and expressed that, but at the same time knew just like when he speaks, I'm quiet. When his elder speaks, he's quiet, you know. So you know, there's a very interesting relationship there between the wise and the knowing. And a lot of times when we're young, we have a lot of knowing, you know, we're collecting knowledge. And like I had mentioned in a segment previously, that up until about 40 years old, you're just information collecting and organizing. Most importantly, you're taking all that information that you have, and like a computer or like a database, right? Which is a better way to put it. Like a database, you're organizing all of the information. And it's not until you get past your 40th mark that you're able to now start applying that information and making it wisdom, and being able to share information, you know, or share wisdom. Let's put it that way. Now, women, their mechanism is a little bit different, and in terms of the way they gather their wisdom, they start gathering wisdom from when they're little girls, from early on, you know, so it's a little different for them, right? But for, in general, men and women, it's not to that age of 40 that you start to be able to express wisdom, right? And again, as always, I have to remind everyone, I'm speaking about Yoruba culture, right? So I'm not, you know, you might say, well, in my household, we da 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 da. That's cool. I'm talking about Yoruba culture, okay? So, like I said, I had that experience, and, you know, it doesn't mean that, you know, what my elder and I discussed we can't do, but we can't do it in the way that we wanted to do it. And I personally don't agree with the wisdom of his elder, but that doesn't matter whether I agree or not. He has more knowledge than I have, and he has more wisdom than I have, and he knows what's best for the family better than I do. You see, with all my knowledge and all my sophistication and so forth and so on, right? So I wanted to speak about that and add the piece in, and I'm going to say, how's this related? Messengers, Eshu, and all of our different messenger archetypes, Mercury, Hermes. But let's just stick to Eshu Ilegba, because again, we're speaking about Orisha, we're speaking about Yoruba, right? So with our messenger archetypes, right, we have a lot of time this concept of bringing information from one place that maybe people don't have access to or don't have the strength or the ability to access, right? Like, you know, you look at, again, certain ideas of being able to go into certain realms, whether it be the nighttime realm of the Iyami and being able to come out safe like a cat can do, the Olobo. The Olobo or the cat goes in and out of that realm with no issue. You know, or again, you may have, you know, different stories in regards to, like the vulture, for instance. In some stories, we have Oshun as a peacock flying up into a room to plead to Olofin, and, you know, Olofin, but during that time, the sun burning her head and becoming the bald vulture. Bald vulture. But then in other stories and other tales in Yoruba, you have the same story, but instead of her flying up and the peacock becoming the vulture, it was the vulture who took off as is. And before that, the vulture had this beautiful head of feathers. It was known for its beautiful crown. And when it took off, what happened was at that time the sun was too close to Aye, or to the earth's surface. So all these different animals tried to bring the sun higher. The possum tried, it wrapped its tail around the sun and it couldn't take it because it was too hot. So it only took it a little bit distance. So that's why the possum has a bald tail. You know, the turtle tried, couldn't take it because it was too hot. And then the vulture did it by putting the sun on its head, but why, as it was lifting and flying it up, you know, like how women carry water and objects and wood, firewood on their head and charcoal, its head got burnt and it lost all its feathers. So that's why the vulture is bald. But the vulture, you know, brought the sun up from the earth away. So, you know, it's different stories there, you know, that different messenger idea. And that's one of the reasons why we know the vultures are such beautiful creatures, because they only serve. People are so scared of vultures, you know, and yeah, they're not the most pleasant looking of animals. But if you think about their nature, they don't harm anyone. They only give to the planet. They're very giving animals, you know. They don't kill anything unless it's dying or wounded severely. But they remove the toxic carcasses from the planet. They have extremely strong stomach acid, so they can break down things that would normally sit there and rot and become toxic to other animals, the other environment. They take them away. And even if you try to attack a vulture, you know, it will first throw up to distract you and to lighten its load, and then it will fly away. Vultures, they don't fight like that. The other interesting mystery of vultures is that you never even see their young. You never see a baby vulture, you know. So they're very protective of their young in that sense, but they don't take from the planet. There'll be more in the vultures. That's coming in my book. I'm working on a book right now, and there'll be some outlining on the vultures. But anyway, you know, I'm always going to give you something. I'm always going to give you the subject, and I'm always going to give you something extra. All right. So you got a little extra this dawning about the vulture, and you got another little extra story that you could tell your children and your grandchildren at night about how the sun was too close to the earth and was lifted up higher by the vulture. So anyway, the messenger, right? Message to the messengers. That was a song that my baba wrote years ago. But anyway, so sometimes we think the messenger has wisdom because they're bringing a wise message. And we don't realize that you can carry a message and not even understand the message. You know, consider a parakeet. You know, a parakeet can repeat whatever it is that you say, but doesn't necessarily understand what it just said, right? So I think about that sometimes when I think about different teachers and preachers and speakers, so forth and so on, who have made careers around regurgitating information, right? And via that regurgitation, we apply a label or an idea of wisdom to them without realizing that, you know, it doesn't take wisdom to repeat something. And there is a big difference between the messenger and the one delivering the message. And sometimes we hold the deliverer, you know, the in-between, in much higher esteem than we do the source. You know, a great example of that is if you look at the Nation of Islam, and, you know, you look at the way people will lift up Malcolm X or even Louis Farrakhan, but really speak about Elijah Muhammad without realizing that, and Elijah called himself the messenger, right? So even, we have to say even there, he was a messenger of you know, Farad Muhammad, you know, who stated that he came as God in the flesh at that time, and Elijah was his messenger, right? So in that instance, you know, still holding the messenger up higher than the actual giver of the message, you know, sometimes we do that to our detriment. And that's when we get into a place where we hold knowledge over wisdom. And knowledge is vital. Don't get me wrong, but knowledge is vital to our growth. Knowledge is vital to just the building and our experience. And knowledge is a cleanser. You know, knowledge purifies, you know. But it is the wisdom that we come through in order to be born. Wisdom births us, you know. So a lot of times we don't understand that the relationship between knowledge and wisdom, of course, then leading us willfully to an understanding or an understanding or an overstanding, right? So, yeah, just the idea of holding the messenger over the message is dangerous. You know, I'm looking at fumble fingers, you know. Nah, I'm not going to say that. I used to have... Well, we're still good friends. Good friend of mine. Let me leave that out. Some stuff y'all don't need to know. That's too vulgar. But anyway, so yeah, I'm seeing in some of the collectives and some of the experiences within the speaking community or the listening community or the learning community where individuals are coming with a level of a beautiful level of the ability to be able to regurgitate facts, you know, like a computer. And I think that's a great talent. You know, I love when I hear people, I have a friend like that. He's a history buff, man. And he will tell you in this date, this happened and that happened and that happened. And when he tells these stories, he really has the ability to put you into that era as he's sharing the history of different things. I've never been that interested in history. I've always been more fascinated by the future. You know, I've always been very fascinated by even science fiction, but anything that was more forward, you know. But that, everybody has their thing, right? You know, so there's nothing wrong with that. I study history a lot because I have to in order to be able to speak intelligently about the things that I speak about. However, it's not... Oh, here come my buddies. Let's see. Let's see. There's one buddy, two buddy. There's another one. But anyway, third buddy. But anyway, you know, being able to speak intelligently is one thing. Being able to speak wisely is another. And wisdom is set forth for leaders. You know, so some of you I hear sometimes get down on yourselves. You know, you're 20, 30, even 40 years old, and you're like, man, you know, I'm still trying to get my life together and this and that and that and that and that and that and that. And I've been studying this and studying that, and I still can't apply it. Well, you're not to the age of application yet, you know. And it's not really until you hit 60 to really, you really find your groove of purpose, you know. Up until 40, you're just organizing all the information. That's all. You're just organizing it. You're figuring out what needs to stay, what doesn't need to stay, what's redundant, you know, what's valuable, what's not so valuable. And then when you hit 40, it's like, okay, now let's try it out. Because application doesn't mean I got it. It means I'm trying it now. And it's not till you hit around your 50s where you start to get some level of understanding. And then it's not to 60 where now you can take the understanding and say, okay, now let me do something with myself. You see? So, you know, like I said, a lot of times people will get down on themselves really heavy without realizing that, you know, you're looking at a lot of messengers, and you're supposed to look at messengers because they're delivering a message to you, and you'll compare yourself to them and say, well, why don't I know this and why don't I know that? You should know it because someone's saying it to you. So open up your ears and listen, and then you will know it, you know, and that's really the key there. You know, instead of trying to emulate messenger after messenger after messenger, don't seek to emulate the messenger. You know, seek to understand the source. You know, it's like sometimes when even people read my work and they'll say like, yeah, I read your books, this, that, that, what's next? And I always say, if you can't teach my books, you didn't read them. I don't care. Anybody can just read some. So you got the knowledge of them. Great. Do you have the wisdom of it? Did you apply it? Do you have the understanding of it? Well, no. Go back then. You don't need 5 million books on your shelf. If you got 3 books on your shelf, learn those 3 books inside and out. Don't just become a regurgitating messenger where you're just passing it down the line, because your messiah is a birth from understanding. You see? When you have the person who understands actually what they read, that's what makes them, you know. Matter of fact, I'm going to give some honor to one of my egun, because he used to always say that about myself, and more importantly about my baba. And he would, you know, so I'm going to give to RL, I'm not going to say his name for y'all, but I'm going to give him honor right now in this podcast. And he would say, boy, you a hellified mother effer. I'm just going to say like he would say it, giving him honor. And he would say, you a hellified mother effer, boy. He said, you know, because you understand what you read. And I would say, yeah. And he would say, no, you ain't listening. And he would always say, you hear me, but you ain't listening. And he would say, you know, a lot of people don't understand what they read. They could read, but they don't understand what they're reading. He said, but you actually, you and your baba, y'all understand what you're reading. So I'm just going to say that out loud to give him some energy. He was an SU energy, by the way, too. So I think it's very appropriate. But anyway, so like I said, you know, don't hold the messenger over the message, and understand that receiving the message is just the first part. It's literally the first part. Being able to apply that information is the next part, and then understanding it comes after application. Not, I listen and, you know, yeah, I heard what you're saying. I understand. You don't understand because you ain't applied it. This is why you'll hear me say that to people sometimes when I'm talking to them, like, you don't even understand what I'm talking about. No, I understand what you're saying. Yeah. You basically saying. As soon as I hear that, I know you didn't understand anything that just came out of my mouth. It's simple, but it ain't basic. Basic is like the word but. You know, I know, but. I know takes you to the ori. But takes you to the butt. Takes you to the root chakra. Takes you right down into hell. I know, but. You basically saying. So yeah, just some things for you to think about on this day. All right. I'm going to get moving because, like I said, I got some things to do. And, you know, willfully, you all have rested well last night. And today will be a restful day, even if it's progressive for you today, but that you'll find some time to rest and get your thoughts right. And think about all the messages that are around you that are giving you the opportunity for understanding. All right. So, this is Chief Yuya signing out from the shrine. I'll see you all tomorrow. Peace, power, respect, and guidance.